World War II had a huge impact on the Bay Area. Sailors from all over the country were introduced to the West as they came through San Francisco on their way to and from the South Pacific. After the war, the city became an attractive place for many of them to start over and create a new life. Skilled workers needed to build ships and supply the Pacific front also flooded the area, and by the time the war ended, many of them had also settled in and found new homes. Russell Lachelle has the story of one such man.
Never before, since Jamestown and Plymouth Rock, as our American civilization been in such danger as now. We must be the great arsenal of democracy. For us, this is an emergency.
In this fireside chat on December 29, 1940, President Roosevelt called for an all-out effort in armament production to help our allies fighting in Europe and Asia. "We must have more ships," he said, "more guns, more planes, more of everything." Less than a year later, like an exclamation point to Roosevelt's message, the news of Pearl Harbor slammed into the shores of America. In Sausalito, California, the Bechtel Company, under government contract, condemned the homes of 30 families, blasted flat the pine-covered hill they had stood on, and built the mammoth Marinships, one of a half dozen instant shipyards that sprang up around the shore of San Francisco Bay. Recruiters spread the word nationwide that California needed workers. Thousands packed their bags and headed west.
My name is Reverend James Miller. I was born July the 10th, 1910. And fact about it, I was bred up in Baton Rouge until I was about 18 years old.
Though ordained as a minister as a young man, Reverend Miller earned his living as a bricklayer, then as a chemical operator. The skin on his stomach is scarred with chemical burns. He told me most men live just 5 years in that line of work. So he went nights to Southern University to learn welding, then heard about the jobs in California.
When I got ready to come to California, they was paying the white man 25 cents more an hour than what I was making. And I was doing his work and mine too. Now that's exactly the reason. I hope you got that now. I said, I'm going. So they said, what? I said, yeah, I'm gonna leave y'all.
I'm going, mama. Babe, I don't know where I'm going. I'm going, mama. I don't know where I'm going.
I left Baton Rouge.
I'm just going, mama.
It must have been 42.
You sure don't be
must have been 42. As close to 42 as I can get. I couldn't get a new way out of Baton Rouge other than a train. I had a car, but I couldn't drive the car here because it wouldn't sell me enough gas to get here. And I came in on the train. And then I went on down Sutter Street to Van Ness and caught me a bus. And he carried me on over to Sausalito, to the shipyard.
The Marinship's yard was in full production when Reverend Miller arrived. 19,000 men and women. There were African Americans, Asians, whites, and Latinos working as welders and pipe fitters and cooks and accountants. Marinship workers produced 78 oil tankers and 15 Liberty ships. On average, one new 500-foot ship every 13 days slid into the waters and set course for war.
If you couldn't weld good, they'd sink the ships out there in the ocean. You follow what I'm saying now? And I mean, I'm a certified welder, not a gentleman welder. I'm a certified welder. And, they give me that respect. They give me that respect. And I thought lots of it because there's no doubt about it. When I weld a ship, I know that that ship had to go and come back. And I didn't want them to hit that ship and tear it all to pieces and say, oh, it wasn't welded. You got to weld them. You know you got to be a real welder to weld a ship the way that they can go and come back like they went. I mean, I welded. I was a welder from my heart.
Reverend Miller climbed the steep ladders up the hull 6 days a week, hauling his heavy welding line from bow to stern to wheelhouse. The ship's holds were broiler hot in summer and chilled in winter. But the money was good, and he took great pride in his work.
I don't care how far it needed to be done this way, I did it. I don't care how far it had to go down this way, I did it. It had to care how far it had to come down here, I did it. Got down here, whatever had to be done long here, and long here, and long there, and down there, on that floor, I did it. Now that's the God's truth. And then Nan come back, tore up. Shoot, I had them folks crying over there like babies. From Japanese and Germans and all them people was crying like babies, telling them to stop the war, stop the war.
Reverend Miller's new life in California took root in Marin City, just 4 miles north of the Golden Gate Bridge.
Mama Mamie, I met her in California. I was at Marin City, and I had a house over there, and I met her there, and she came from some part of Texas, and I saw her, and she talked my talk. She was a school teacher. And I fell in love with her. So we got together, and she had this little boy. He was something like that. And he didn't have no dad, so I was just glad to have him, something like me, you know, and close where I could raise him. And I read him up to a manhood.
After the war, Reverend Miller continued welding as well as plastering and cement work. Today he lives in a comfortable bungalow in Oakland, across the bay from Marin City. He has no regrets about staying on in California.
I stayed here. I ain't been back there to stay since. California don't like the abuse people. They like to give you what you got coming. And if you don't have it, you don't have to make it. You can't make it. But when you show them that you know that you know, they treat you like that.
You know, I can almost see the top, well, top of the hill. You know, I came through.
Reverend Miller brought many things to California. His welding skills, his work ethic, his passion for preaching. And he also brought many people from back home who, like him, were looking for a better life.
Yeah, and nieces and nephews and cousins and folks ain't no kin to them at all. Men and women, they ain't no kin to them at all. I brought them on out here where they could make a good living, and they living good. Living good, doing good for themselves, all over California now. Some of them I don't know where they live, but they're living good. Yes, sir, I did that. I really did.
This piece was produced by Russell Lachelle. This is Hot Soup. I'm Penny Nelson.